All right. Good morning, everybody. This is Panama Bartholomew with the Building Decarbonization Coalition, and welcome to Building Decarbonization Coalition Presents, our sometimes once a month, sometimes twice a month, sometimes even more webinar series, where we try to bring in some of the top thinkers, top doers, top innovators within building decarbonization to talk about hot topics within the field. Thank you so much for joining us for today's presentation on contractor needs assessment results. The Building Decarbonization Coalition hired EMI with the help of Southern California Edison, the consulting firm EMI, in order to help us interview a whole bunch of contractors to be able to better understand contractors' views, fears, biases, and needs around building decarbonization and what it's going to take for them to be able to switch from installing fossil fuel-based appliances over to all electric appliances. And so just a reminder of who we are. The Building Decarbonization Coalition is a multi-sector coalition of energy providers, manufacturers of heating equipment, the design and construction community, local governments, and non-governmental organizations. We're a nonprofit that works on completely eliminating emissions from the built environment, both through policy solutions as well as market-based solutions. We released a roadmap in January of 2019 that laid out what we thought California would need to do in order to be able to achieve zero emissions from the built environment. And so we called for the state to adopt a building code no later than 2025 for residential, saying that would lead to zero emission buildings, new construction for residential buildings, and the same for commercial buildings no later than 2028. And that the state implement a series of policies that lead towards reductions of emissions from the existing building stock so that by 2045 or sooner, we'll have completely eliminated emissions. Inherent in that was some proposals for the increasing the market sales of key technologies such as air source heat pumps and heat pump water heaters so that by 2030, they represent 100% of the market share in California. So a big, big switch over the next 10 years. Behind these numerical goals, though, we identified a series of barriers that were going to need to be overcome if we're able to achieve those numerical goals. And the five laid out in the roadmap are up on the screen here is we need to dramatically increase awareness across all stakeholders of the benefits of building electrification. We need to ensure there's a robust value proposition for customers. So that's both on the capital cost side as well as operating costs. You don't want to be spending more on electrification. And then there needs to be, and this gets very much to today's presentation, a really secure value proposition and a better value proposition for installers and builders to be going all electric than fossil fuels. We need to get the supply chain not only ramped up, but barriers out of the way of the supply chain through things like undersized electrical panels. And then we need to align our policies to meet the other goals. And so our energy efficiency policies, our affordable housing policies, our school construction policies, et cetera, they need to align with our climate and clean air policies. So this webinar series really gets at that awareness piece. And this is one of the ways that we seek to raise awareness about the benefits of electrification is trying to have this webinar series to talk through this some more. So we're really excited about today because it also hits on that third value proposition of making sure that installers are getting a good value proposition. What does that mean? So we have some other great webinars coming up. I just wanted to tell you about May 14th. We have Scott Shell from EHDD Architecture Firm is going to be talking about that we can electrify every building type. And so he's got a great presentation showing just across the board, I'm going to say literally every building type and models of how you can electrify those. So that'll be May 14th. And then on May 28th, we have one of the leading designers for central heat pump water heating systems. And Sean Oram from Ecotope is going to come in. He's going to give a reasonably technical presentation about how to effectively design central heat pump water heating systems. And so that should be a really great one as well. For today's webinar, everyone's muted. We had about 150 organizations that registered to join, so we wanted to keep everybody muted. Please ask any questions you have via chat, and at the very end, we'll ask Donna to answer those questions. We are recording this, and that includes your chat, so don't be rude if you don't want to go down in posterity for being such. And then members of the coalition can access the recording on our website, so after the fact. And not only that, but you get so many other great benefits of being a member of the coalition. Fantastic membership benefits of getting to work together with other leaders within the building decarbonization space. And so we would love for you to join us in the coalition, join us on future webinars. Here's the website to be able to join the coalition. So with that, I'm gonna stop sharing and hand it over to Donna. And Donna, as you get your presentation up, I'll give an introduction. So we wanted to have a opportunity to talk to installers. And this is water heating installers, HVAC installers, general contractors, and electricians to have a understanding of how they view electrification, what their fears are of electrification, what it's going to take for them to be able to make the transition towards installing all electric, and then what do they need from policymakers, program administrators, and permitting agencies in order to be able to make the switch. And the goal is to use the findings from this report to be able to use that with those entities, policymakers, program administrators, and permitting agencies, to recommend changes to make it easier and more profitable for installers to be going over to all electric. And so this is the first step in the process. We're great to work with Edison and EMI, and I'm going to hand it over to Donna now to walk us through the results of our contractor needs assessment. So with that, Donna, please take it away.
Great. Thanks everyone for attending, and thanks Panama for that introduction. Okay, here's the agenda of what we're going to talk about over the next 35-40 minutes or so, saving some time for questions. I'm going to talk about the methodology we use to collect all this data from the various types of contractors and installers. Then I'll talk about, take a little bit of step back, talk about all of the objectives of the study, and then I'm going to actually go into key findings. So we'll talk about what the major findings are from the study, and then we'll launch into the details behind those key findings and get into a lot of the detailed results. And then I'll conclude with a discussion of some of the recommendations that we have. Okay, so the study consisted of 39 in-depth interviews with a variety of contractors across the state of California. So 10 HVAC contractors, 10 electrical contractors, 10 general contractors, and then 9 plumbing contractors. These interviews were completed in October through December of last year. They lasted about 45 minutes each. They were pretty robust conversations, and we did provide a $75 incentive for their time in completing those interviews. One of our main goals here in recruiting for this study was we wanted to make sure we had good representation throughout the different portions of the state. So we want to make sure we didn't concentrate everything in the north or in the south, vice versa. So that was, we got pretty good representation there. And then we also wanted to make sure that in our interviews, we were getting a variety of perspectives with respect to the topic of electrification of residential homes. So this was a self-report question we asked during the screening process and asked if they feel very informed, somewhat informed, or not at all informed. And the goal there was to make sure we weren't just getting people who didn't know anything or just getting people who felt that they were very informed on this topic so that we could get a variety of perspectives. I do want to talk about study limitations. As with any research, there are limitations that we want to keep in mind as we talk about the results and what those results mean. So even though we did have almost 40 interviews, it's still a pretty small sample size when you talk about, you know, generalizability of findings. So, we didn't conduct this to be a quantitatively representative study. It's more of a qualitative study that's going to tell us some ideas for things to test and try out. And it's going to be able to help us document the variety of perceptions that are out there. That's really what we were aiming for. But like I did say, we did try to get a geographically representative or at least diverse sample of perspectives and then a different types of perspectives related to electrification as well. We did have our sample sources generally come from coalition members, so there was some limitation in that respect. I would say that likely skewed results toward greater awareness of electrification and more positive views, but you'll see when we get into the results that that wasn't always the case. We did have a variety of perspectives, in fact. Even with those limitations I'm talking about, I personally feel pretty good about the findings and talking about them as being representative of what's out there in the larger population, because they do really fall in line with some other research that's been recently conducted. So things are pretty consistent with some other research, which is always good to see. Okay, talk about objectives here. So main objective here, to identify and explore the attitudes of a variety of contractors towards electric end uses that can advance near-term and long-term building electrification in California. So those target electric end uses are space heating and water heating, particularly heat pumps and heat pump water heaters. So we want to look at contractor preferences related to gas and electric, their awareness and perception of this specific equipment that I mentioned, drivers that influence contractors to recommend or install electric over gas or vice versa, any barriers to adoption, and then also receptiveness to policies and ideas that can support electrification. Okay, getting into the key findings here. There are a number of them, so I'm gonna walk through these, and I think this will give you something to kind of hang your hat on as we get into the more detailed results later in the presentation. So we found that plumbers had the most negative associations with electrification compared to the other types of contractors that we spoke with. They generally had a preference for natural gas and saying that was less costly and actually more efficient. And that was cited as a barrier to installing heat pump water heaters. So just kind of not being aware of that technology. And then electricians were the ones least familiar with the term electrification compared to the other types of contractors that we spoke with. And they didn't really have super concrete attitudes toward heat pump technology either. I think some of that confusion is just based on the idea that from an electrician perspective, when you say electrification, that might mean, or the first thing that might come to mind is installing electricity or electric in a home rather than converting from gas to electric. Across the board, across the different types of contractors we spoke with, there was a preference for natural gas as a fuel source. So some of them we talked to said that they had a preference for electric and that was perceived as being safer. By far, natural gas was preferred and that was viewed as being cheaper and more reliable than electricity. And then just to note here throughout the presentation, I'm using this HP to refer to heat pumps, and you'll see HPWH to mean heat pump water heater. Perceptions of heat pumps were that they were costly, and there were some concerns about how they were going to perform on those colder winter days and the concern of needing a backup heat source. The benefits associated with heat pumps were that they could help lower carbon footprint, and they were energy efficient as well. And then heat pump water heaters similarly perceived as being energy efficient, but there were a number of drawbacks cited by respondents. So the main thing that most respondents brought up was that they required a longer amount of time to heat water. There were some other concerns such as a need for maintenance, the higher upfront costs, concerns about location, where it would be installed, and then the amount of space it takes up. And then this lack of awareness of heat pump technology could prevent both optimal installation and use. So this was coming from the perspective of the contractors we spoke with, telling us not just, you know, that there might be some need to increase awareness among contractors, but also among customers. So specifically, respondents said that a lack of a whole house approach for installing heat pumps could mean they're not always performing optimally. And then also customers not being aware of that technology could influence how they're operated. So for example, customers may not quite be attuned to the idea that they want to keep the thermostat within a narrow range rather than making these high jumps in temperature and expecting that as they would with a gas furnace, for example. So some of that lack of awareness on both the contractor and customer side that our respondents brought up. Okay, and then there was a perceived need for panel upgrades for both heat pump and heat pump water heater installation as a barrier. Perceived is the key word here because it may or may not be necessary depending on the specific situation. But those wiring issues were particularly top of mind for heat pump water heaters, as they would require both a plumber and electrician for the installation. And then we wanted to look at if there were any concerns about supply of heat pumps and heat pump water heaters. We had found in previous work that there were some concerns, and we didn't see that in the study. So that was something interesting we wanted to point out here. Our respondents said it had been difficult in the past to obtain heat pumps or heat pump water heaters if you wanted to get that in a short time frame, but most of our respondents this time around said they didn't think they would have a problem getting the equipment, so that's good. We also asked about financing and if respondents felt that would be helpful in selling electrification projects, particularly with low-income communities. Some of our respondents expressed concerns about that, although most of them felt that would be useful. We can get into more of that later in the presentation. Respondents, when we asked about California's greenhouse gas reduction goals, were generally not very fluent in what exactly that entailed. We had some different variety of responses and what that association was for these respondents. We can talk about that and the need and desire for training in that area as well. Okay, a lot of key findings here. This is the last one. We did ask about training and if contractors would want to have training related to California's decarbonization goals. And generally the respondents were favorable. They were willing to engage in training and preferred in-person seminars or webinars. They really wanted, though, for any training to highlight how that impacted their business and what it's going to mean for their bottom line. So making that very practical for their business. Okay, I'm going to jump into detailed findings now. I'm going to start with attitudes toward electrification. So this figure here is showing generally where respondents lie on whether it's positive associations with electrification, negative, or if they were just simply unfamiliar over on the right-hand side there. And overall, the most positive associations we saw were with our general contractors and the HVAC contractors. I'm going to get into that a little bit more here. So general contractors generally express positive views. They associated electrification with switching from gas to electric as a fuel source. And then they thought about it also as lowering their carbon footprint. So this quote here, just one of our respondents from the general contractor group saying electrification is close to their heart. So they have some personal investment in this. Okay, and then HVAC contractors were also generally positive toward electrification, but they also had a little bit more variety in their associations in the sample that we spoke with. So 5 of our 10 HVAC contractors said that they actually mentioned electrification when working with customers. And then a couple of them, they were unfamiliar with the term at first, but when we describe it as fuel switching, then they understood what that meant. And this particular interviewee said that's something they actually do all the time. Typically, however, they were switching customers from propane to electric rather than natural gas to electric, but it is something that they're doing. And 4 of them said that they felt especially positive about electrification when they combine it with solar installation. That really made sense for their customers. Okay, so we're going to get into more of these negative associations with electrification. Here, as I mentioned earlier, plumbing contractors had the most negative associations with electrification, and that mirrors some other results from previous studies as well. They really preferred gas as a fuel source, and they felt that electrification was costly and that it was going to be less efficient, particularly when you talk about recovery rates. And when we were doing these interviews in the fall, there were some power outages going on in Northern California. So our interviewees actually mentioned that as well, and that was at the top of their mind. That had some negative impact on how they felt about electrification. This respondent here, quoting here on the right-hand side, kind of interesting, saying that for most of the people in their county, decarbonization and electrification are kind of bad words. So quite a negative association. Okay, and then getting into more of the unfamiliar respondents. Electrical contractors were definitely less familiar with this concept of switching from gas to electric. They didn't really associate that term electrification with switching, but they did think about it as being associated with high costs. So this quote here on the right is kind of helpful for understanding their perspective. My immediate association with the word electrification would be providing power, electric power, to an existing structure. It's not a term I've ever used before. Okay. So here we had, as I mentioned, pretty lengthy conversations with these interviewees, and so we didn't always get to ask every question of every interviewee. So I want to point out here that the results I'm about to show you, we actually only had 13 total respondents who answered this question, but I think it does still give some insight, and it's again, in line with other work that's been done on this topic. So we asked if they had a preference for gas versus electric, and we had 13 that cited a preference, and we asked them what their associations were with that preference. So here we have 9 respondents who preferred gas or natural gas, and generally, they associated natural gas with being cheaper than electricity. And then interestingly, we also heard that in their view, natural gas was no less clean than electricity. So they were linking electricity with less clean sources, such as maybe coal plants and things like that. And here we had 4 respondents who preferred electricity as a fuel source. And here, obviously not a lot of responses, but something we've seen in other work as well is that association of electricity is just being more safe than natural gas. So there's some opportunity here to kind of capitalize on that positive perception with electricity. Okay, so now getting into the perception of electric equipment, and again, specifically, this is going to be about heat pumps and heat pump water heaters. Got some icons here just to help us keep on track, because we do kind of flip back and forth between heat pumps and heat pump water heaters. So got these little images here to help us keep track of where we're at. Okay, so looking at heat pumps, and these are the benefits of heat pumps. So this is across all of our respondents. The most common benefits cited were a lower carbon footprint, and then also energy efficiency associated with heat pumps as well. Several other benefits that you can see going down the list here. Four of our respondents did mention that heat pumps provide both heating and cooling. It's perhaps an opportunity to raise the awareness of that benefit. It's something that heat pumps provide. Okay, so still looking at heat pumps, but this time the perceived drawbacks. There were some performance concerns in cold weather, which I mentioned previously. That was the most common response across all four of our groups of contractors. Close second there, high upfront costs associated with heat pumps. Okay, and then switching to heat pump water heaters, the benefits here, energy efficiency, the main one, and then again, lower carbon footprint, second most common. The biggest drawback for heat pump water heaters was the perceived time that's required to heat water for this type of equipment. Then there are also some maintenance concerns and a variety of other concerns that we heard from respondents as well. Okay, so I'm going to dive into each of these findings by the different groups of contractors that we spoke with. So looking at general contractors first, they were a little bit different. You know, they are probably not installing this equipment, but perhaps subbing that work out. So they have a different perspective here. It's kind of interesting. The benefit they most frequently talked about was the versatility in style and installation options. So for example, they talked about, well, you can have a wall mount versus a ceiling mount, some just different options like that. And the drawbacks, interestingly, also kind of centered on that physical component. So talking about the aesthetics of mini split wall units as being a drawback. And they also mentioned high upfront costs as well. So for the aesthetics, this quote here, people don't like the look of the thing hanging on their wall, right? That's just something people are not used to. Okay. And then now heat pump water heaters, general contractors mentioned benefits, primarily a lower carbon footprint and greater energy efficiency. And the drawbacks they mentioned most frequently were the space required and where they would locate the water heater in the home. So this quote, really emphasizes that point there. They're larger in size than the typical water heater. They're a little noisy. They make the space that they're in cold, so they're not ideal for interior installations. That could be an issue. Okay, moving on to the HVAC contractors, looking at heat pumps, the benefits for them most frequently was related to a lower carbon footprint. And the drawbacks there, they were concerned about the need for another heat source in cold weather and high upfront costs as well. So this respondent here, this quote saying, in our area, it would be just the fact that the colder it gets outside, the worse they work, and that's when you need it the most. And then looking at heat pump water heaters among plumbers, the benefit most often cited were opportunities for energy efficiency. And the drawback was related to difficulty of maintenance and service. We particularly heard that plumbers felt like there was just a shortage of knowledgeable service technicians and additional, they're concerned about these mechanical systems that they felt like were prone to breakage. This quote here on the right, most of these guys can't work on regular water heaters that are just strictly gas, let alone you mix electric in them, and then they get few and far between. So this quote is kind of harsh, but it's pointing out at least the idea that there's really a shortage of plumbers who are knowledgeable about heat pump water heaters and how to install them. Okay, and then electrical contractors looking at heat pumps really just had difficulty thinking of the benefits and drawbacks. And specific to heat pumps, three said they didn't know the benefits and two said they didn't know the drawbacks. So just not a lot of responses because they were not familiar with that technology. Saying the decision was completely made between the HVAC contractor and the general contractor, and so I wouldn't know the benefit or the drawback. So not super engaged in decisions around the technology. Okay. And then looking at perceptions of heat pump comfort. This is a question we specifically dove a little bit more into in our interviews and got some feedback from HVAC contractors and general contractors. Both of those groups described the importance of installing heat pumps in conjunction with an evaluation of the entire building envelope in order to provide the most comfort and the most energy efficiency. So four of our general contractors and three of our HVAC contractors said if installed correctly, heat pumps should be able to provide as much or more comfort than a standard gas furnace. The general contractors sometimes felt that the HVAC contractors weren't always installing heat pumps using a whole house approach. So they saw an opportunity there. Five HVAC contractors and five general contractors also described a need to educate end users, again, on how to operate heat pumps optimally. There's just this need for behavior change in how customers are using a thermostat when they're operating heat pumps. The quote here, so say an HVAC contractor, they might take a normal split system and put a heat pump in. Okay, they do that all the time. But are they going to make sure the ducts are air sealed? Are the ducts even adequate? Those are some of the concerns that we heard. Okay. Talk about barriers to adoption as well as drivers to adoption of heat pumps and heat pump water heaters next. So overall here, a couple things I wanted to point out that cut across the four different contractors we talked about. We heard several installation challenges that were a barrier to increased adoption. Notably, this perceived requirement of electric panel upgrades, and also the costs associated with these more complex installations. Respondents also underscored the drawbacks of poor installation. So kind of going back to that last slide, where if we don't take into account the entire system when we're installing this equipment, you could actually have reduced comfort. There was concern that there could be greenhouse gases leaking from the refrigerant. You could oversize the equipment, make it less energy efficient, some things like that. So looking at specifically installation challenges for heat pumps, the primary challenge here were the panel upgrades that might be needed. Those were seen as being expensive and time consuming. Interestingly, no general contractors describe panel upgrades as an installation challenge, but we did hear that from a number of electricians and one of the HVAC contractors. The quote on the right-hand side, that is kind of a roadblock in some cases. You're going to have to spend a few more thousand dollars just to be able to support that electric appliance. It can be cost prohibitive for some people to do that. Okay, and then we also heard quite a bit about this idea that you would need a backup heat source for heat pumps. So even though that heat pump technology is improving, respondents continue to recommend a backup heat source, particularly in certain situations. So 16 of our respondents said they always or sometimes recommend installing a backup heat source. Four of those said they would only install a backup heat source if their client lived in a very cold area. And two said they only install backup heat for clients in remote locations. So some differences in when they recommend it, but 16 of them saying they always or sometimes have those recommendations. The quote says they've really improved them. So even in our North County where it drops down in temperatures, that really doesn't matter anymore. There was a wives' tale and urban legend that, you can't use them in cold temperatures, and that's just not true. So some realization that maybe you don't always need a backup heat source, but we definitely had some different perspectives on this topic. Okay, and then insulation challenges related to heat pump water heaters. The primary challenge, again, was this perceived need for panel upgrades. They also described lack of installer knowledge that made installations of heat pump water heaters just more complex. And again, this quote here on the right talking about how, a good portion of the plumbers out there may need some training to really understand or to get up to speed on heat pump water heaters. But also there's this issue. So why would a plumber want to learn something like that when he could put in his normal water heater he's always put in and get several done in a day if he wanted to? So I think the issue here is what is the motivation for plumbers to begin installing this new technology? Respondents often mention that the installation of a heat pump water heater would require both a plumber and an electrician, again, increasing the cost associated with that installation. The plumbers mentioned that they would need to work with an electrician. One plumber said that he would do some electrical work himself. Five electricians said they wouldn't do any plumbing because their license doesn't allow it. And one mentioned that he would work with a plumber, but he felt there were plumbers who would install heat pump water heaters without an electrician. So in some cases, maybe not working with the other trade, but generally realizing that that's what's required. If I had a heat pump, you'd have to have an electrician come in and run electric to it and all that stuff. So realizing if they're going to install that, it's more complicated of a process and it's more costly. Okay, last section of detailed findings, receptiveness to policy supporting electrification. So we heard from our respondents some awareness of California's carbon reduction goals during our interviews, but we asked them specifically about, can you say exactly what those goals are or what the source of those are? They had trouble identifying those specifics and a lot of difficulty tying in what that meant for their industry in particular. So 27 of our respondents said they were familiar with California's carbon reduction goals, but again, many of those could not identify what the specific goals were. 11 said they were not familiar. So this quote over here on the right talks about basically where they kind of get their information about policy changes. Whenever they change policy, usually the supply house tells us because they have to abide by it also. They can't sell equipment that's not allowed. So they come to us and tell us, hey, we're coming out with these new models and I'm not fixed on any particular system or model, so I don't see how that would affect me at all. So this particular respondent is saying they don't have a real reason to try to follow what these goals and policies are. They just go with what's available. Now, when we asked about would financing options help for selling heat pumps and heat pump water heaters in low-income communities, this was a particular concern. 16 of our respondents said they felt financing would be useful. They said incentives, some of them said incentives would be better than financing, however. Some said that financing would be useful really only if it were associated with low or no interest loans. And those in favor felt that any assistance with bringing down upfront costs would be useful as well. So not just financing alone. 9 respondents did not feel financing would be useful. And several of those said that low income end users just don't need to take on additional loans. They have enough financial burden already. The quote over there on the right really highlights that. One thing that always kind of gets me across is when you talk about somebody who's low income, financing is the last thing they should be doing on anything because of the interest rates. So here, if there's that low or no interest rate, that would definitely be more palatable to this respondent. 2 respondents also mentioned that utility bill costs would also need to be reduced along with their upfront costs, which makes sense. Okay, and then looking at potential training for contractors. Most respondents were optimistic about training, but they wanted to make sure that they were applicable to their trade, that they were also a low time commitment, and they wanted to know how it was going to positively impact their business. What is in it for them? 24 respondents stated they felt a training on the decarbonization strategy would be useful. And only a few said they didn't think it would be useful at all. And then 6 of those respondents said, they kind of qualified their answer. They said, yes, it would be useful, but again, that needs to be convenient for me and it needs to make business sense for me. The quote here, until people are educated, they're gonna keep doing what they've always done. Even with proper education, we're going to have those guys out there that just don't wanna change until they're forced. We asked how respondents would like to receive training. The most common kind of equally split here between in-person training and then online training through webinars. The quote here, I'd rather sit down in a classroom and have an instructor helping it out. When it's done in that way, you have an opportunity not only to learn from the instructor, but other people around you that might already be involved in it that have ideas. Okay, so last few slides here, I want to review our recommendations and then leave some time for discussion as well. Okay, so first one is to support rebates and incentives for fuel switching and for upgrading to efficient electric equipment. So we heard over and over that upfront costs are really that big barrier, and that's something we all are familiar with hearing in this industry. So that's going to motivate our end users to pursue those options and then help contractors sell that equipment more frequently. Secondly, to promote manufacturer training to installers about proper installation and maintenance techniques. So manufacturers have an interest in ensuring that installers understand the installation requirements and making sure the equipment's properly maintained. And right, they don't want their equipment being poorly installed and then customers perceiving that it's some fault of the equipment itself. So the idea here is to promote that training to installers so that they can understand proper installation techniques and really get at those misconceptions about the performance of heat pumps in cold weather. And some of those perceptions that we heard about maintenance requirements for heat pump water heaters. Okay, third one here, provide education to installers regarding how electrification and carbon reduction goals impact their business. So we heard that installers are interested in learning more about what electrification is and how going green can be cost effective and good for their business. But the question they had is really, how is that going to affect their bottom line? What are the economics about this? So it's important that this type, any type of training or education about this, focus on that and how it's going to impact their business. The fourth one here is to educate also end users on the benefits of electrification and efficient electric technologies. Some of the installers might not want to recommend or install equipment until the customers are demanding it, right? They're going to keep doing the same thing that they're doing. That's, you know, bringing in money for their business. So they might not change until the greater market changes. So we want to also educate the end users. And then in doing that, helping customers understand that there could be some different expectations for operating this equipment compared to their old gas furnace that they might be used to. Next, provide marketing materials and training materials for sales staff and installers. So this is some collateral that installers can use when they're pitching that equipment to end users and also when training their own staff. So their staff are aware of, you know, the benefits of heat pumps and heat pump water heaters. Materials should underscore the cost effectiveness and any available incentives for that equipment. Next here, provide low interest or no interest financing options to engage low-income end users. So for addressing that particular market, financing options, generally we heard from contractors would be helpful, but we don't want to place any additional monetary burden on these households. So those loans should ideally be low or no interest. We could also include the option to pay at least a portion of the loan directly through their utility bill savings. Okay. That's all I've got. I think we have some time.
Wonderful. Thank you, Donna. We've had a really robust conversation going on over in the chat. So a couple follow-up questions. Did you in the survey differentiate between large contracting firms versus smaller contracting firms?
We did not break out our analysis in that way, but I'm sure we got a variety of large and smaller establishments. So our sample included a variety of sizes.
Okay. There's a question about permitting, and I saw it come up a few times in your presentation. There's a perception that permitting shops, permitting agencies are really familiar with gas water heaters, and it's pretty simple to permit them if they get permitted. And that perhaps there's some fear about permitting for heat pump technology. Did that come up in the conversations and in the interviews?
Oh, that's a good question. Trying to recall. I feel like that did come up once or twice, that very issue. And I don't remember specifically what was said, unfortunately.
Okay. Thank you for that. And then there's a quite a bit of conversation about financing in here. And I'll just say that the for all of you interested in the financing thread here, the Building Decarbonization Coalition is just about to release a paper on accessible financing, particularly looking at on-bill tariff financing and its application within California's policy context. And we hired an all-star team to put that together, and we're going to be releasing that report within the next month and having a webinar about that pretty soon as well. So stay tuned for future webinars on financing. When maintenance came up quite a bit in the questions, Donna, was there more detail about what this maintenance was that the contractors were concerned about, or that they had biases or perceptions about? Like what was the need? Why was there additional maintenance needed for heat pumps versus the gas units?
You know, I'm not exactly sure what the concern was. My perception of this is that it's more of an issue of being an unknown technology. And it was, just a kind of a lack of knowledge of how this equipment operates and what the maintenance needs are.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The question from Mark about, did you talk about how heat pumps could replace air conditioning systems? I'm guessing that panels that can handle air conditioning can handle heat pump replacement. And I think the issue here, Mark, I'm guessing, is that, you know, in a lot of coastal California without the air conditioning, a lot of homes without air conditioning, and therefore undersized panels, that's probably what the contractors are referring to. But anything additional to add to that, Donna?
No, I think that's exactly right. The undersized panels was the issue. I'm not sure I could add any more.
Okay.
Wonderful. Eventually you'll ask me a question I can answer.
Yeah, absolutely. Ruby from Southern California Edison says, following up to the maintenance question, would additional maintenance be due to contractors that didn't know how to install this stuff, perhaps not installing it correctly? That's a interesting point, Ruby.
Yeah, definitely possible.
Yeah. So we are coming to the end of the presentation, the end of the questions. We will be releasing this study in the coming weeks. If you saw this on Twitter, if you saw this on LinkedIn, if you got this via email, you're in the channel that will be releasing these over and alerting people to this final report. We want to thank you for joining us today in the Building Decarbonization Coalition Presents webinar series. We hope you join us for future webinars within this series. And I really want to thank Southern California Edison for being a strong partner and co-funding this study. And I want to thank Donna and EMI for carrying out this effort. As she said, you know, this is hopefully a early addition to the body of work around contractors and their needs around electrification. So thank you all for joining us. Thank you to the team that put this together. And good luck decarbonizing out there, everybody. We're going to shut the meeting down.
Thank you.